and welcome to A Current Unfair. I'm Michael.
And I'm Sammy.
And we're the most extroverted people this class has to offer.
Tampons, a Mennonist, and Migaloo the albino white whale. What do they have in common? They're all white and a bit droopy.
And these are the issues we are discussing tonight on A Current Unfair. Yes, get ready for half an hour of wholesome family fun brought to you by the tired, weary media students of RMIT. These dullards haven't had time for a squirt in 2 weeks due to their never-ending unpaid hours imposed upon them, with only those liberal art degrees they pursued to blame, simply because someone told them they were funny one too many times.
This show is here to tell the hard truths, backed up by hard facts. Our sources span from Wikipedia to SparkNotes. There's no arguing with our approximate knowledge of Australia's newsworthy affairs. Our journalistic integrity rivals that of the brand power lady wearing a fedora with a little note reading press tucked into the band.
Unlike other news shows on the air today, we embrace the upload to YouTube because that's all our budget allows us for. And we aren't even bitter about being booted off Channel 31.
The dickheads.
Now let me throw in a plug for the dirty, flirty and inserty issues made of cotton tissue, the tampon tax.
And before we get started, we are ovary jokes about the menstrual cycle, period.
Anyone who objects can leave the bloody womb.
And shut the pelvic floor on the way out.
I'm going to flow this one to Sammy as she investigates further.
Don't we all just love periods? I love bleeding out of my vagina every month. I love riding the cotton pony. I love the way menstruators get a little indulgence every month. The way we get to use luxury items such as pads and tampons. Yes, that's right, luxury items. Getting your period every month isn't just annoying and painful, it's also expensive. Every month, our budgets go out the window when we have to try and afford luxurious items such as pads and tampons just to keep ourselves clean and comfortable when birthing a blood diamond. There is currently a 10% tax on sanitary items in Australia, and many other countries around the world are facing the same problem. But okay, sure. You may be thinking everything is taxed, but actually it's the non-essential items. Things considered essential get to avoid the GST. Things like lube, condoms, and lobster. I don't know about you, but I know I struggle to go more than 2 days without my expensive shellfish. Thank God it's not taxed. We already know that the gender pay gap exists. According to the gender pay gap statistics by the Australian government's Workplace Gender Equality Agency, on average, women earn $277.70 less than men. That's like 46 boxes of tampons. Sexism within the workplace is already an uphill battle that women have to face. And on top of all that, us bleeders are expected to fork out a further 10% for a box of tampons just to stop our body from being covered in menstrual blood. Who made us pay this GST in the first place, you may ask? Well, let's first discuss the fact that the people who decide what gets taxed and what doesn't get taxed are, realistically, the government. And since the dawn of time, women continue to be significantly underrepresented in parliament and executive government, meaning it makes it harder for them to have their say in this area. This dill pickle has a good $10 to $20 worth of tax pads that are completely useless for him, sticking to his left arm for crying out loud.
I have no idea why states would tax these as luxury items. I suspect it's because men were making the law.
Hell! Even our big brother himself thinks that this is bollocks. But how could people who don't menstruate ever possibly understand why sanitary products are a necessity? Just use tissue paper? Are you fucking serious? Come on, we've all been there. And no, it does not work. It's like Arts and Crafts Week at Panty Camp. And it's not just the trolls of the internet. Aren't politicians meant to be an example of some of the country's smartest? Why are we still debating this?
No. And I've got to say, I'm not going to make a promise that I can't keep.
He won't make promises he can't keep? Ugh! Mate, you're a politician. You're running for Prime Minister. Broken promises are basically a prerequisite for the position. But Joe Hockey thinks that sanitary items should be GST free. At least I think he does.
I think so.
You think so or you know so? Get to the point, Mr. Hockey. Let's take things down to the front bottom line. Should or shouldn't the tampon tax go? Oh my God, holy shit! Yes, the answer is yes! But wait, then why am I still sitting here making the point that we in the Red Wedding Party are still being taxed on Shark Week every month? I did some research into this whole fighting GST on stupid things subject, and what I discovered was truly astounding. There was a point in history, 1773 to be exact, when the men of the United States of America got pissy at the government for taxing what they considered to be a necessity. In protest, they raided the import ships and threw all the crates of essential cargo into the ocean, and they started a revolution in the process. What was in those crates that caused so much anger amongst the people, you may ask? Tea. Tea. Bloody tea. They started a revolution over taxing tea and then gave it some fancy pants name like the Boston Tea Party. Ladies, I say we commandeer a cargo ship of tampons and throw it all over the edge. We'll be hitting two birds with one stone, making a political protest in the most immature, yet apparently effective fashion ever, and we'll be helping with the rising sea levels. Win-win! Viva la revolution! Our government classifies tampons and pads as luxury items, but condoms, lubricant, nicotine patches, and lobster, for fuck's sakes, are considered necessities. What? Oh, okay. So maybe game shows should include tampons as the major luxury prize amongst a list of tropical holidays and cars, considering tampons are supposedly a luxury. Hey guys, guess what? I want Deal or No Deal, and they gave me a lifetime worth of tampons. You may be wondering, what could I possibly do to help? Well, the first issue we need to be addressing here is to legitimise the menstrual cycle. It's 2016, and yet discussing period-related issues is still considered to be taboo. Earlier this year, Instagram deleted artist Rupi Kaur's picture with a period stain on her pants and bed, as this was reported as inappropriate. And seriously, what is up with all the blue liquid used in all these pad ads? The last time I checked, my period is not blue. I don't think these pads are created for aliens. It's called surfing the crimson wave, not wading in the sapphire puddle. So once you've mastered the skill of throwing around ludicrously taboo words like tampon, pad, and uterus, go ahead and sign up to the Stop Taxing My Period campaign, created by the very same university student who posed the question to Joe Hockey on Q&A following the release of the 2015 Australian budget.
Mr. Hockey, do you think that sanitary products are an essential health good for half the population?
She's already reached over 103,000 petition signees, but is aiming for 200,000. What a bloody legend! We'll get you there, love, and we'll get our revolution! Purchases of sanitary items everywhere. And this includes you, awkward-looking guy on aisle 7, trying to figure out if this partner needs a mini tampon or a maxi pad with wings. Everyone, we need to stand together and fight for what is rightfully ours. This is no tax, it's blood money. No retreat, no surrender. That is Spartan law. And by Spartan law, we will stand and fight and die. A new age has begun, an age of bleedom or freedom. Simple answer, we just want tax-free tampons. The great flood cometh, period. Tampons for all!
Welcome back, and apologies for that interruption. Next, we delve into the dark world that is the internet. Whilst usually the internet generates cultural phenomena such as Grumpy Cat and Gangnam Style, there is a dark side, a side we do not speak of often. No, I'm not talking about Kanye West's Twitter feed. I'm talking about Meninism.
Heed this caution, we're about to delve into the darkest, most contentious discussion on the internet. We're going where no RMIT student-run TV program has ever gone before.
Trigger warning, everyone. We're about to have gender discourse.
Meninism, the much needed and completely valid answer to feminism. Just as feminism has fought over the years for the basic rights of women, including being able to vote, own property, work, and have control of their bodies, so too has feminism come into the arena to fight the good fight, to demand that men get free drinks too. The Cosmopolitan stop ogling at our bulges and that men shorter than 6'3" get a look in with the ladies, whilst refusing to date women who are feminists of colour, too short, tall, fat, skinny, wear makeup, don't wear makeup, opinionated, educated, make more money, etc. All while refusing to be at all introspective about why women might not want to date them.
The idea of meninism started out on Twitter in December 2013 with hashtag Meninist Twitter. Urban Dictionary user and famed orator Spootyhead and real human journalist Molly Robinson view the hashtag and its origins as being a joke, an edgy satire of first wave feminism designed to humour the online community. So while we thought everyone was having a laugh at hashtag meminism, there were some tweets from men that bleed into disturbing social commentary.
Turned off your messaging button because you couldn't handle the heat, hey. You've got over 200,000 blokes coming for you. Ha ha, your house will get burnt to the ground within a week. Come the fuck at me, you filthy, sweaty, red-headed pig. You're a fucking idiot, you bitch. Men are not always a cause of violence. Pull your fucking head out of your dyke's asshole and then hang yourself, dog.
Not all men, babe.
Around November 2014, the idea of meninism started to be linked with groups that actively oppose feminism, like this charming group of trust fund dude bros who created the club hashtag Founding Fathers. The Founding Fathers was formed in opposition to their school's feminist society, who claimed to have been sexually harassed by these tarot cash VIPs. And considering that this photo is now on the internet, the hashtag Founding Fathers will likely never be fathers themselves, but at least they have their hashtag Chino Goals, hashtag Polo Training Thursdays, hashtag Mum Pack My Lunch.
Damn, Daniel, back at it again with the white vans.
And this is symptomatic of a larger issue, where there is genuine disrespect, disregard, and straight-out hatred of women by these men.
It all started around the time that pesky women started demanding equal pay. Those broads started screeching about consent, asking us fellas not to text their tampons or hit their Malby wives and whatnot. To hell with them Danes. Us men tried to reach out to them with things like a special pen made for just their brittle, weak fingers, which are only useful for sewing, powdering their noses, or tending to the children. Because nothing says equality like a pink or violet pen made to demystify the complex task of putting ink to paper like a Bic for her. No, no.
These dated views may seem funny to you, but they are earnestly held by iconic neo-masculinist douche. Darish Velizadar, a former biologist of the microkind, posits some strange views like that men who date fat women are causing America's national obesity problem. Roosh rose to fame in Australia earlier this year after he was denied entry into our country, where he planned to hold what he calls tribal meetings. Unfortunately, this isn't as simple as just pulling off a blindside and voting him off the island. These sessions are about coaching men on using physicality to pick up women, as if the name tribal meeting isn't enough of an indication of just how dated his views are.
Believe it or not, American women are not perfect. They have a lot of flaws. They're fat. Bad girls are simply unattractive. They cut their hair short. They make themselves ugly on purpose. Their idea of cooking is using the microwave or preparing macaroni and cheese.
According to a blog post on his website, one of Roosh the Douche's teachings is the groundbreaking notion that the word no does not in fact mean no. Instead, a man should yield sexual advances at the sound of the word stop, because no and stop are clearly two different things. Parmesan?
No, thanks.
No, you'll like it. I promise, babe.
I really don't want parmesan. I'm not in the mood for cheese.
You don't know what you want. You just haven't tried the right Parmesan yet.
Please, I'm lactose intolerant. I don't even like cheese.
I'm like a roller coaster, babe. There's a point of no return.
Stop!
Well, you could have said stop earlier, sitting there with that plate of pasta like you want cheese.
Someone call the people trying to force the cheese onto you. Pickup artists, who are not to be confused with waiters, who will generally respect your request for no Parmesan, regardless of whether you use the word no or stop.
These followers of Roosh, as well as other meninists, try to convince as many women as possible to have sex with them, using techniques like negging,
wearing down a woman's self-esteem so her standards will drop,
winging,
a group of men approaching a target woman, whereby one will attempt to seduce her whilst the other fends off obstacles, such as her friends,
and plain old selective hearing.
For example, the word no. Most women who bruise the egos of PUAs by somehow restraining themselves from jumping on those lynx-douse sex magicians get told that it is still their own fault for getting sexually assaulted, usually based on the merit of what they were wearing.
From this, we can gather that a woman wearing a slutty outfit that exposes her skin is similar to tempting a cat with a piece of raw meat. It's like brandishing a tasty tourist to a captive tiger. You just can't blame it for attacking.
In fact, in July this year, a woman was attacked by a captive tiger at Badaling Wildlife Park in northern China. Amazingly, the woman survived, but her mother was killed whilst attempting to rescue her daughter. We will now be joined by the tiger, Tony, involved in the brutal attack. So, Tony, we've been hearing a lot about this incident lately on social media. Tell us about the attack.
Why are they calling this an attack? People on the internet can be so classless. I was merely strolling around my stately enclosure one afternoon when I saw the damsel in distress.
But people are saying that she didn't want to be attacked.
Hey now, let's all be reasonable. It's just science fact. If she's walking around in my park like that, dressed like a tourist, then she can expect old Tony here to have a little pounce.
Well, Tony, you really have the internet up in uproar.
Look, either tourists can grow teeth and claws and defend themselves, or they can stop walking with tigers if they don't want to get eaten. A tiger can't change his elegant stripes.
Tony, I think we'll have to disagree on this one, buddy. But thanks for taking time out of your busy mauling schedule.
I asked for Monster, goddammit.
And we've lost him. We will be right back after this break. This is a story we see over and over. A story of celebrity harassment. Jealousy, lust, delusion. What could cause these fans to go wild and endanger an innocent life? They are pestering and harassing the Sandra Bullock of the Pacific, all the way from New Zealand to the Sunshine Coast. At times, necessitating a police escort. Do these people have no shame? Tonight's special report details the complicated journey of a local celebrity that could have ended in disaster. The pure, glamorous, and commanding figure at the centre of this story is, of course, Migaloo the White Whale. For those of you who don't keep up with the world of Megavateria Nova Angelae gossip, I will harpoon about whaling until you tell me to leave. Up until the early 60s, whaling was a mammoth business. These graceful creatures were hunted for food, oil, medicine, and tennis rackets? Australian vessels used to kill up to 800 humpback whales every year, as well as illegal Russian vessels killing up to 24,000 in just 2 years. In the mid-1960s, humpback whale sightings reached their lowest point, with only 200 seen in 1 year. Around the world, action was being taken to protect the marine mammals and outlaw whaling. In the past 50 years, numbers have recovered remarkably well, and 25,000 whales were seen migrating up the east coast of Australia in 2015. The centre of tonight's focus is Migaloo, name meaning white fella in the Maya Katuna Aboriginal dialect. This majestic, rare whale was characterised by his distinctive and almost unique complexion. It was love at his first sighting in 1991 off the coast of Byron Bay, a time where he was the only known white humpback whale to exist. During the years to follow, he became the poster boy for the species and the annual migration up the east coast of Australia. Over time, Migaloo has gained a celebrity-like following, with the legions of dedicated fans obsessed with sighting the whale and sharing their enthusiasm with the world, sending in every sighting to be logged on fan sites. Over time, Migaloo gained a celebrity-like following, with legions of dedicated fans obsessed with sighting the whale and sharing their enthusiasm with the world, sending in every sighting to be logged on fan sites. Just like the Beatles, One Direction, or dare I say it, Justin Bieber. Migaloo's fans can get quite passionate and treat a mere sighting of the whale as a near-religious experience. Here are some real quotes from, let's call them, Migalutherans. I cried, I screamed, you gorgeous whale, thank you for being here with us today. I had the trip booked on the off chance we'd be able to meet with Migaloo. The conditions were perfect. The sun was shining. He came over to our boat. He came under our boat. The dolphins came in. It was truly incredible. I've been fortunate enough to have about 6 experiences with Migaloo. And there are even people transcribing the divine words of their idol into English. Well, I mean, it's obvious that this translates into this. Crikey, indeed! Now, a whale's definitely a bit odd. Having an obsession with a white whale surely can't be fatal. So what's the big deal? With populations returning to healthy levels, no more whaling, and a shining white representative and an enthusiastic public, the plight for whales is over, right? All's well that ends well and so forth. Well, not exactly. A lot of these problems involving injury, stress and discomfort to our lovely whale friends, like Almighty Migaloo, come from ignorant whale enthusiasts who want to touch Migaloo more than they want to have babies with George Clooney or to get the perfect Kardashian contour. Such treatment of celebrities can even increase the risk of mortality, hence why Macaulay Culkin looks like he's about to kick the bucket. We got in touch with some of these fans earlier this week. Let's have a look at what they had to say.
Oh, I'm back at my place, please.
No. But never fear. Our lovely friends over at the Australian government have created official guidelines to follow when dealing with whales and dolphins to protect them from crazy fans, such as Migalutherans, such as maintaining a certain distance from animals. For instance, boats are not allowed within 300 metres and aircraft are only allowed to fly above at a certain altitude. And being fans of Migaloo and lovers of nature, people would obviously obey these guidelines. I mean, most people, especially whale-watching tourism companies, would obey them. Surely! Unlike religion, interacting with Migaloo and his brethren can have some serious financial penalties. And when I say serious, I mean serious. With the maximum penalty for moving too close to a whale being $20,113.50. I guess the difference is, if you get too close to a god, it's a life-changing spiritual experience and a moment in the spotlight of the mass media. Like winning religious tats lotto. Woohoo! Praise Migaloo! But if you get too close, it's like being forced to buy over 2,300 unlucky Tats Lotto tickets, all at the once. Now, whales have very sensitive hearing that is critical to their communication, navigation, and hunting. Human-made sounds can mask the important stuff or even damage their hearing. So this probably sounds just as annoying to Paul Migaloo as it does to us. To provide a professional explanation on how to properly interact with whales, please welcome Dr. Jonah Pequod from the University of Israel. Welcome, Dr. Jonah.
Jonah couldn't be here today. Digestive issues. However, as his intern, I can provide you with the same information. When we are around whales, it is very important to keep our distance. This is good. This is bad. Flash photography is also not allowed. This is good. This is bad. As tempting as it may be, we must never, ever swim with the whales. This is good. This is bad.
Thank you, Dr. Jonah Pequod's intern. That was a very insightful, and I'm sure we've all learnt a lot of valuable lessons about whale safety. And let us not forget that humans and animals in close proximity can end in disaster. When something goes wrong, all efforts are directed at preserving human life at the expense of animals involved. Take Harambe, for example. The gorilla that was killed when a...
Harambe was a saint! Dicks out!
In conclusion, have some respect for whales and leave poor Migaloo alone. By all means, create your shrines of worship for your favourite animal celebs. Enjoy and appreciate nature, but do it from a respectable distance. And don't let your enthusiasm for nature's wonders compromise that very beauty which we all love so much. I'm Michael Serpell. Thank you. Oh, and one more thing.
My. At Byron Bay I fondly do remember. Oh yeah, I saw you, my one true lover, swimming out in the bay. The siding log on the shelf is always repeating itself. Migaloo, I was transfixed from the shore. Migaloo, promise to watch you forevermore. Migaloo, couldn't get close if I wanted to. Migaloo, finally facing my Migaloo. Migaloo, finally facing my Migaloo. My, I was in my little boat, but you were longer. Oh yeah, couldn't get closer, police guarding you with all their might. And how could I ever refuse? Whales don't belong in zoos. Migaloo, I was transfixed staring from the shore. Migaloo, promise to watch you forevermore. Migaloo, couldn't get close if I wanted to. Migaloo, going north to Maine is what you do. Migaloo, finally facing my Migaloo. And how could I ever refuse? Whales don't belong in zoos. I was transfixed staring from the shore. Migaloo, promise to watch you forevermore. Migaloo, couldn't get close if I wanted to. Migaloo, going off to mate is what you do. Migaloo, finally facing my Migaloo. Migaloo, finally
face in my neighborhood.